he's from everlasting to everlasting. He alone is God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's a great day to be alive. The taste of his goodness and his grace and his mercy. He's an all-knowing God. He's a good God. Hallelujah. You know how greatly you're loved this morning by the Father? You are greatly loved by the Father. You're all he thinks about. Everything he does it with you in mind. When he was hanging on that tree, he wasn't hanging there for himself. He had you in mind. I'm glad. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. God, I give you glory. I give you praise. Heavenly Father, what an honor it is to be in this great house today with these great people of God. Thank you, Father, for how you have watched over us and taken care of us and made ways for us. You've been our provision, our protection. You watched over us last night as we slept, God, and you didn't let anyone hurt or harm us in any way. And we woke up this morning, Father, kissed by your love, strengthening our bodies and in our minds, oh God, and we're so grateful. And you brought us into this house, and we've had the distinct honor of coming to the communion table this morning in remembrance of all you did for us. And Lord, we say thank you. Thank you that sin shall not lord it over us. Sickness and disease cannot take over our bodies. Mental anguish cannot have our minds. Lack cannot have our finances. The kingdom of darkness cannot have our marriage, cannot have our children, cannot have our nation, cannot have our church. And God, we give you glory this morning. And we thank you for it all. In the precious name of Jesus the Christ, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Well, don't let me praise him by myself. Hallelujah. Because the same God that woke me up this morning is the same God that woke you up this morning. The same God that took care of me all week is the same God that took care of you all week. Amen. And he did it because he loved you. He did it because he loved you. Amen. Hallelujah. We're going to talk this morning about renewing your mind. Renewing your mind. You know, we're living in some very trying times, some very difficult times, some troubling times. We're seeing things that we've never seen before. Wow. I'm telling you, we're living in a day where they're calling wrong right and right wrong. We're living in a day they're trying to make you believe because you are a born-again believer and you love God and you want to do what's right that, you know, something's wrong with you. And so we're going to have to renew our minds to the things of God. Renew is to take something back to its original design, what it was before something else happened to it. And let me tell you this morning, renewing your mind on our part is going to have to be intentional. It's going to have to be deliberate. And it's going to have to be on purpose. We're not going to walk into the peace of God. We're not going to walk into the joy of the Lord. We're not going to have what God says rightfully belong to us if we don't renew our mind to what he said. And he can't renew your mind if you haven't put your mind there. When I was sitting at the table last night just seeking the Lord and asking him about today's service and what he would have me to share with his precious people, And so many of us want what God says he has for us, but we don't want to put in the work. We don't want to put in the work and the time that it will take to receive what God has for us. Remember when we had, I don't know, it was last week or whatever, we were talking about the sower and the seed. You can't, confession is good, but confession will not bring a harvest where there's no seed. And the Lord told me last night, so much of the body is trying to reap a harvest where there's been no seed planted. And the seed is what? The word of God. What would a doctor think if a married couple came to him and said, doctor, we want to have a baby. And he said, okay. And he run tests and everything, and she's healthy, and he's healthy. He said, well, I don't see any problem why you can't, you know, conceive and have a baby. Oh, well, we don't sleep together. You see why that won't work? You're going to have to come together. And then, oh, well, y'all looking at me real happy, but it's okay. That don't bother me at all. I know what God told me. And we're trying to get what the word says we can have, but we're not planting the seed. We ain't spending no time in the word of God. We're not. We're so caught up in the world and what the world is doing and those kind of activities and stuff. We'll stay 2 and 3 hours on the ball field. Are you fussing? No, I'm not. I'm giving instructions. Watch movies 2 and 3 hours. Go to the ball field, all these other extracurricular activities, and you can put the whole week together, and you probably haven't even spent 1 hour in the word of God. How you think you're going to get to know him? How are you going to be able to function and operate in the things of God when you are not allowing the teacher to teach you what are the things of God? It'd be real silly for a farmer. I'm going to go over there and get Deacon, I'll say Deacon Terry because I know he plants a garden and stuff. And I'll bring Deacon out and purchase some land. I said, come on, Deacon Terry, let me show you my land. Now, brother, my corn's going to be right here. My green beans are going to be right here. My beets are going to be over there. And he'll look at the ground. It hadn't been tilled. Soil ain't been turned over. Ain't no seed. It's tree limbs and roots and grass. In other words, nothing's been done to the soil to get ready for the seed. And he'll look at me and he'll say, you gonna have what? I said, child, yeah, I can have whatever I say. That's what the word say. The word says I can have whatever I say. He'll look at me in his very mild tone that he speaks, Apostle. You don't have any seed. I mean, the ground is not. Oh, no, there ain't nothing impossible with God. All I got to do is believe. Because I'm born again and I'm spirit filled. Glory to God. I'm a tither. I don't miss a Sunday church. I don't miss a service. How many of you know that when it come harvest time, I'm not going to get anything because I haven't planted a seed? And we're trying to get to know God. How you going? And it just, the Holy Ghost just on me. Like, I mean, I'm telling you, I'm sitting at the table literally weeping. He said, because my people have rejected the word. We're in this place where we want to come in church This might not be, and that might be why I told us to take communion first. Come in church and you want the pastors or somebody you feel is spiritual to anoint you with oil and blow on you. Those days are over. It's time for us to grow up. The Father's wanting to turn his business over to us, but he's not going to turn it over to the children. He's going to turn it over to the sons. The sons are the mature ones. How can you believe God for something you hadn't even heard? Faith comes how? And hearing what? So if you never hear the word, faith's not coming. And the only way you receive from God is how? By faith. Everything we get from God, we receive by faith. So if I don't plant the seed of God's word in me, my soil is my heart. See, it's not the soil that produces a harvest, it's the seed. Not the soil. It's the seed. I got to put a seed in there. And then I've got to cultivate that seed, and I've got to water that seed, and I've got to feed that seed in order for that seed to grow. And when I put that seed in me, he already told Joshua to meditate the word when? Day and night. Meditate it. Study it. Read it. Meditate it. Muse it. Dissect it. Oh, God forbid, get a study guide. You know, we read the Bible, but I don't believe a lot of God's people, and I'm not just talking about Lifeline. I believe that a lot of people, when they sit down to read the word, engraved in our minds is what we've been taught before. Some of it was true, some of it was not true. But the Holy Spirit wants us to be open to revelation. He wants us to be open to knowledge. He wants us to come to him and say, when you sit down and read, you say, okay, now, Holy Spirit, show me what this really means. Show me how this applies to me and what I need to do to get in agreement with this so I can have what you say. Because we got the same spirit of faith that Jesus had. And because we have the same spirit of faith that Jesus had, we should be getting the same results. I've had enough of not getting the same results. And I know God's not withholding anything, because he said it's his good pleasure to give us the kingdom. The world has to see, because they cannot spiritually discern anything. So they have to see. They have to see somebody that names the name of Jesus walking this thing out. They have to see a sick body being healed. They have to see a person. You remember the demoniac that was in the tombs and he was cutting himself and they would put chains and things on. He'd break the chains and everything. But the Bible said when he saw Jesus, wow, when he saw Jesus, and Jesus rebuked that demon, and he got his same man back. He was naked at the time, and he was running in the tombs and cutting himself. But when he saw Jesus, can I tell you this morning, if you ever see Jesus, if you ever see Jesus, your life will never be the same. Won't nobody have to talk you into praising. Praise team won't have to stand up here and close their eyes and try to sing because of what they're seeing out there. Let me tell you something. Until we come in here ready, we're not going to, 2023 can come, 2024 and 2025. You ain't going to see nothing no different. Because you're bringing the same old stuff. You bring your excitement. You bring your expectation. Have you prayed for the service this week? Have you prayed that apostle would hear God and have the right word? Have you prayed that God would move among the body and whatever needs there are in the body, that God would meet the needs? Have you asked God, what can I do to be a blessing to you today? See, we got to do more than get up and get our bodies ready to come to church. We got to get our spirits ready. Get our minds ready. Get excited about God. No way that they should have to tell Sister Sharon, should have to get up and say, everybody stand. When praise and worship, we're talking about the King. When the Panthers run on the field, they don't have to tell all the Panther fans to stand up. And you ain't going to get none of their money. If they would win the Super Bowl, you ain't going to get no ring. They ain't going to even let you wear it. And we're talking about the God that wakes us up every morning. The God that puts life, health, and strength in our bodies every day. Don't let's be like the disciples when the woman came to him with the alabaster box and she broke it. It was very costly oil fragrance. And she broke the alabaster box and she anointed him. Now listen to this. His disciples say, why was this waste? Why was this waste made? This could have been sold. Judas wasn't interested about no poor. He was robbing and stealing out the bag. Why was this waste? Now these disciples have been with Jesus. They've seen him heal the sick, open the eyes of the blind. They've even seen him raise the dead. I'm talking about Jesus. And when this woman come to anoint him for his death and burial, they said, why was this waste made? You have to ask yourself a question. Do you see coming to church as a waste? Is it just a filler? Is it just something you do, you know? Or do you really believe that when we come into the house of God and we become united, one in mind and spirit, that God can manifest himself in here and do what we saw him do when he was on earth? Do we have that kind of expectation? Do we have that kind of excitement? Or is he just an add-on? Yeah, that's why we had communion first. Romans 12. Renewing our minds. Y'all, we got to get back to what's first. We got to get back to what should be priority. And it takes renewing mind. A lot of times, how many of you know life will handle you? Sometime roughly. Life will handle you roughly, and sometimes because life has handled you roughly, it can mess with your thinking, how you see things, experiences, hurts, and things that you've gone through. It can obscure how you see things, and so you got to get your mind renewed. Renew back to the way God says things are. I can't believe like God if I don't know what God said. Talking about renewing the mind. It's got to be intentional. You gotta want to know what God knows. You gotta want to have God to get actively involved in your life. Don't shut him out of any area of your life. It doesn't matter. What area of your life? Without him, there's no help for that area. Because believe you, whether you believe me or not, he knows everything. Got to put the work in. That's what he kept telling me last night. He said, daughter, they're not willing to put the work in. You, as somebody will say, Apostle, I want you to believe God with me about thus and so. And I asked, well, what scripture are you standing on? None. Do you know that saying? And when the storm come, and it's coming, when the winds blow, and they gonna blow. And if all your foundation is sand, then whatever you're trying to build on is gonna sink. It's gotta be built on the foundation of the rock. Because the word says faith come by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, it would just stand to reason that the more I hear, the more faith will come. And if the more faith comes, the more I have the ability to believe God and to see God. If you and I go to the store and you got $100 and I got $10,000, you're going to be looking at the price tag. That don't mean nothing to me. Because I've got the necessary funds to buy whatever it is I want. You only got $100. So you're going to have to be very strategic about what you get. $10,000, I can just stretch out. It's the same way with the word of God. When you put that word of God in your heart and you put it in there on a continual basis and you water it and you feed it, the same storm that could come to your house will knock you over. It won't move mine. And see, this is what God is wanting us to see. We're putting so much on the devil. The devil ain't got no power. He's a liar. He's a bully. He's an unemployed angel. He doesn't even have a valid kingdom backing him. You and I have a valid kingdom. We've got the kingdom of Almighty God backing us. We've got the authority of his name. We've got the power of his blood. We've got his word, which is forever settled in the heavens and the earth. We've got a battalion of angels. We've got the precious Holy Spirit living on the inside of us. So we have a valid kingdom that is recognized in heaven, in earth, and beneath the earth. So a lot of us, we're just lazy. That's just it, point blank. We're just lazy. I could go around the room today and I could say, what scripture have you studied? Some of you will. What scripture have you studied today, this week, and what have God ministered to you out of that word? Just keep looking at me. But see, you got to get hungry for the, you will never change until you get sick and tired of being where you are. And it's insanity to keep doing the same thing over and over and expect to get different results. That's insanity. You don't spend no time with God, but you expect to hear God. That's insanity. Glad I didn't get voted in. Romans 12. You know, y'all able to eat this. This tiger meat this today. Y'all able to eat it. Says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now, I can't present your body to God for you. You have to do that. It says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed, how? By the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. He said, don't be conformed to this world. Don't be fashioned after this world. How is it? And I use sports because a lot of people just into sports. You can tell me all the players on certain teams, their stats and all that, and you can't list all the books in the Bible. How is it that you can tell everything that's in the worldly realm? You know that. And you'll get in a conversation, no, so-and-so did, no, no. And then when you get the word, silence. But he said, we're being conformed to the world. We're being fashioned after the world. We're in the world. We're the light and the salt. That's what the Bible said. We're the light of the world and we're the salt of the earth. We are to make a difference in the world. When he gave me that statement for this year, he said in 2023, we have to make a bold, righteous stand. You got to make a stand for what's holy. You got to make a stand for what's right. If ain't nobody else doing it but you. And it's going to take boldness to do that. Because when you make a decision that you're going to live holy, and be lit, when I say holy, that don't mean no makeup, dresses down to your ankles. Holiness is simply agreement with God. That's what holiness is. Holiness is to come into agreement with God. It has nothing to do with your clothes, which if you come into agreement with God, then certain things you won't wear, certain places you won't go, certain things you won't get involved in. When you come into agreement with God, because if you belong to God, then God is your Lord, then he should be able to direct your life. There should not be one thing in your life that God cannot direct, because after all, he's always right. You got so many believers got to wrestle with whether they come into church or not. Whew, my goodness. You don't wrestle like that on Monday morning. It could be raining. It could be snowing. We want so much from God, but we give him so little. There's things that the Holy Spirit just wants to reveal to us and to show us, but we don't have time for him. But he said, we got to renew our mind. That you may prove what is good and acceptable. If you don't get in the word of God, you won't know what's right. Because I've heard people, this guy was on the YouTube, and he was talking about how there are no more apostles. And I mean, he was going at, he was pulling scriptures and everything. It was all out of context, and it was wrong. But if you didn't know that that wasn't true, you would believe it, because he was very convincing. This is why God wants you to get in the word for yourself and know the truth for yourself. Because he told you in the last days there was going to be false prophets, false apostles, false pastors, false teachers. It's going to be all that. And the Holy Spirit is the only one that can help you discern whether what you're hearing is of God or not of God. But if you don't spend time with him, and I'm going to keep saying this, and when y'all start doing it, the Holy Spirit will move me to something else. Philippians 4 and 8. And believe me, I'm not fussing. I'm trumpeting. I'm sounding the trumpet this morning. I hope it sounds throughout all your land to let you know we're in some serious times. We're in some perilous times. Amen. The reason you're so discouraged is because you don't know what God said. My Bible tells me that there's a way of escape made. That God watches over us. He rejoices over us with songs of joy. And when you don't know that, the things that you are presently facing or being challenged with, they will overwhelm you. Because to you, they'll look bigger than God. You remember when Elijah was there with his servant, and the servant went out and he looked up into the mountains, and he looked up and all those armies had come against just two men. Just come after Elijah. Ooh, when has hell been thrown in a panic because you got up? When is the last time the devil said, oh, bring me something for my head, she up again? When is the last time you caused hell trouble instead of hell troubling you? Philippians 4 and 8, it says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, that's power, and if there be any praise, what did he tell us to do? Think on these things. It matters where you let your mind go. It matters what you allow to go into your eye gates and your ear gates, because that's going to paint a picture on the canvas of your mind. He's telling us what to do. He said, I want you to think on things that are honest, things that are true, things that are just, holy, pure, good, lovely. And if there be any praise, think on these things. It matters what you give your mind over to. If you sit with foolish people, you're going to be foolish. How is it you're so comfortable with people that don't love God and you say you love God? How is it things they do that goes against the word don't bother you? We got to decide which side of the fence we're going to sit on. Your bold stand will cause somebody to come to Christ. And that's what we wanted to do. Your bold stand, your stand for what's righteous. And that don't mean you beat nobody over the head with the word or anything. If somebody come up to you, oh, guess what? It's tax season. And I'm doing your taxes. You tell me to add about 5 more kids to my taxes. Some of y'all look like, oh no, we got a lot of, but don't look at me like that. We got a lot of believers do that. And that's not honest. That's not good. And that's not just, because when you do that, what you're telling God is you're not able to provide for me. You're not able to take care of me. So I got to do this thing on my own. That's dishonest. Well, ain't nobody going to know. The one that sees all and knows all and hears all, he know it. So you've done this, and then you come running to God and you wanted him to do something for you. What kind of seed did you plant? Oh, this ain't gonna make you shout, but this will help you. And even when you work, Eric works at McDonald's. It's not right for me to go through that line because I'm her grandmother and she gives me extra and I hadn't paid for it. See, it's them little foxes. Oh, we want to holler about adultery and homosexuality and all that. How about you in the grocery store and you got ice cream and you decide that's not the kind you wanted, but you way on this side of the store and you really don't feel like walking back over on the other side, so you just stick it right there. Because after all, they're charging you too much for the food anyway. They got those carts, those stations for you to put your cart in. But I'm parked over here, so I'm just going to put my thing there. It could run and ding somebody's car. Well, it ain't my car. See, there's reasons why things ain't working. Perhaps you're getting harvest off of what you've been sowing. You mean God cares about that? God cares about everything. He cares about everything. Well, you know, I went and the lady gave me $20 too much. Ooh, look, ain't God good? That's not God. See, this is why he said you got to think on whatsoever is honest and just and good, and that's not good. That woman's going to have to, that draw is going to be short. It could be that she even get terminated for it. But we got on What Would Jesus Do bracelet, all these shirts with these Jesus slogans and things on it, and that lady, you know, cut you off and you cussed her so that, you know, I'm serious. I'm talking about believers. I'm not talking about worldly people. I expect that from them because who's living on the inside of them? But because of the seed of God that's on the inside of you, that shouldn't even be coming out of your mouth. That kind of conversation shouldn't even be coming out of your mouth. Ain't no slip. It can't slip if it ain't in there. But see, when you're full of something else beside God, Second Corinthians 4:16. See, I'm believing God for some awesome things this year, just like I did last year. But I know that I have my part. No, I ain't got to work to get God to do it, but my life's got to be honorable and clean. Because if I'm going to get harvest off of what I sow, do you keep your word? You expect God to keep his to you. Do you keep yours to him? Or do you keep your word to others? Second Corinthians 4. Verse 16. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is what? Renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Now, if you don't know that this is, Apostle Paul is telling you, this season you're in right now, this situation that you're in right now is a light affliction. But some of it has looked at it like it's a life sentence. It's merely a light affliction. God, your great deliverer, delivered you out of that, and he will deliver you out of this because he has not changed. There's nothing more powerful than the name of Jesus. There's nothing greater than God, but it has to do with what you think in your mind. It matters what you think in your mind, how you perceive things, how you see things. If you're a hurt person, then everything that you look and see, all you're going to do is you're going to look at it through hurt, through what was done to you. Everybody's not after you. Everybody doesn't want to do you harm. But which cause we faint not. And if you don't have the word of God as your foundation, if you don't have the word of God as your solid revelation, when trials and troubles and tribulations come, you will faint. Yes. Proverbs said, if you faint in the day of adversity, then your faith is small. We need to feed our faith daily. Faith is our servant. And you are to send that servant out to work for you every day. Okay, say for instance, you got somebody coming to your house, and say for instance, they clean up your house. And they come in. When they come in, you take their coat, you take their purse and everything. You tell them, sit down at the table. Let me fix you some breakfast and a cup. That's not how that works. You came to serve me. Faith is your servant. Faith will serve you. Let's give him strength to serve. If you haven't fed your spirit the word of God, your servant faith is emaciated. He's weak. He has no strength. He can't even lift himself. But if you've been feeding him daily the word of God, been feeding him his Wheaties, then when trouble comes, faith has the strength to stand up. Hope will run under there and undergird faith till what you're believing God for comes to pass. But if you don't feed your faith, it's just like your natural physical body. If you don't feed your natural physical body food, you will get weak. Well, your spirit, it's the same way with your spirit. If you don't feed your spirit the word of God, I don't care what nice little cliches you can say when I come around. It'll show. It's time for us to grow up. We've been in this thing long enough now to know that there's nothing greater than God. There's nothing more powerful than God. But it has everything to do with the way you think. There's a lot of people say that the United States of America is doomed. I say Jesus is Lord of the United States of America. So as long as he's Lord, the United States of America is not doomed. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. There'll never be a time where there'll not be food and water and shelter. The earth is the Lord. And God said, I know how to take care of those that belong to me. And I don't know about you, but I belong to him. So I have to watch what I say. Because what I say, my words are magnet. It's like a magnet. It draws things to me. If you're always talking about how sad you are, guess what you're drawing to yourself? If you're always talking about how weak you are, how sick you are, how tired you are, how disappointed you are, guess what you are attracting to yourself? The seed you sow. Listen, don't be deceived. Whatsoever a man soweth, that, the Amplified says, that and that only. Do you remember when Jesus went to his hometown and the word of God said he could do no mighty works there except lay his hands on a few sick people because of their... Well, if unbelief will stop the Son of God, what you think it'll do about us? Unbelief will keep God from working in your life and my life. That's why God wants you to renew your mind. Stop living out of your natural carnal thinking, out of your five senses, what you see with your eyes and hear with your ears. God wants you to open your spiritual eyes so you can see that he's greater than all, that he's a God that keeps his word, that there's nothing impossible. God handpicked every miracle, every sign, every wonder in this Bible, and it's enough to let you know that if you can even get thrown into a den of lions, I know how to shut their mouth. If you get to a Red Sea and it's impassable in your life, I know how to make that water stand up on both sides and let you cross over. I know how to take two fish and five loaves of bread, and I know how to divide it up and have at least 12 baskets left over. He said, I handpicked those things to show you that I'm a God of which there is nothing impossible. Well, since he's a God that changes not, he's the same God now that he was then. He's still the God of your Red Sea. He's still the fourth man in the fiery furnace. He stayed in there because he knew in this life we were going to be thrown into the fiery furnace, and he stayed in there so that you could come out without even the smell of smoke on you. It matters what you think. Matters how you see things. Matters what you feed yourself. Child, I just can't get ahead. Well, I can't because he's my head. He have anointed my head with oil. He's anointed Jesus with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord. It matters how you say it. They're talking now, oh, COVID's coming back. It came to my house when it came out, but it it ain't coming back. But if it do try to come back, the same one that got rid of it then is the same one to get rid of it now. Death is not my portion. Life, long life. I got that out of here. Got to renew your mind. Sit up and talk foolish stuff all day long and then think you're going to have some wisdom. Ephesians 4:23. Well, child, you know, I don't want to hurt nobody's feelings. You don't have to hurt nobody's feelings. Just let your yay be yay and your nay be nay. We have allowed the world to water down the word for us. We've watered it down. God doesn't want us watering the word down. He wants us to serve it in truth. That's the only way it'll change your life. It's the only way it'll help you. Amen. Ephesians 4:23 says, and be renewed. Oh, let's go up. Let's see where I want to start. Go up some more. Let's start with 11. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Now, remember when I said that guy was on YouTube and he was talking about why there are no apostles and no prophets? Ephesians 4:11 says, and he, who's he? God. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. Now see, I'm not angry at this man. I'm not going to debate this man. I just know the truth. So my mind is renewed to this truth. Because only what God says is true. I don't care how many collars you got on. I don't care how many degrees you got on the wall. A fool can have a lot of degrees on the wall. Because if you just got natural knowledge and you don't have any spiritual knowledge, then you are a fool indeed. Because God said when he give his gifts, he don't take them back. So we still got apostles. Now we do have some wannabes. Made themselves. You listen, I don't care where you go in life, whatever realm of life you're in, you're going to have the false and the good. In every race of people, there's good people in every race of people on the face of the earth. And then there are not so good people in every race of people on the face of the earth. That's just how it is. It has nothing to do with the color. It's just got to do with just man being man. What we yield ourselves to. It says, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. See, all of us are supposed to be, all of us are joints, and all of us supply. No one person here has it all. You have a part, you have a part, you have a part, you have a part. We all have a part. It's just like your natural physical body. You got a right arm, you got a left arm. You got a right hand, a left. And you need all this. Stump your little toe on your left foot. See, won't your whole body receive that input? Your whole body gonna holler, ah, it will affect. It'll cause you to limp. That's the little toe. On the left foot, hidden out of sight, but if you hit it and you bruise it, it's going to affect your entire body. That's why as the body of Christ, we need to be mindful how we live and how we carry ourselves, because you can make the body cripple. Oh, not, yes, you can. If you are a part of this body and you're doing stuff you know you ain't got no business, you're causing leaven to come in here. You're causing a door for the enemy to come in this ministry. But I'm on the watch. I'm asking God, don't let nothing get by me. Oh, that didn't go so well, did it? But it's true anyhow. See, because God's holding me responsible in this house. Y'all can never come. I'm going to be here. If everybody decide to leave, I'm going to be here. Because this is my place called there. This is my assignment. Until he released me, this is my place called there. So I have to renew my mind. I can't let the fact that some come and some don't come. Some is witches. You can't allow that. Jesus didn't allow that. If he had, how successful do you think his ministry would have been? When he told him, unless you eat my body and drink my blood, over 5,000 of them left him. He turned around to his 12 disciples and he said, y'all going too? Let me see what I got to work with. It's time for us to quit begging folks. You either want to do right or you don't want to do right. Can y'all tell I've been with Jesus? Yeah, it's time out for placating and babying folk that don't want to do right. You laying on your bed crying. You can't eat. You can't sleep because they want to act a fool. Pray for them. Put them in the hands of the Lord and go about your business. Because you can't change them no way. If you could change them, we wouldn't be having this discussion. I ain't sending out no invitations to church. If this is your place called there, you're sure. And if it's not, ask God where you're supposed to be. I want you to be where you're supposed to be because I want you to grow. I want, because wherever you're supposed to be, your place called there, God has put the word in that man or woman's mouth for you that will help you grow, will help you to bloom, to help you move into that next dimension. I don't want to just hold people so I can have a, say I got a full church. Full church of what? Full church of unbelief? Full church of angry, bitter people? No. So we got to renew our minds. That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro. You got too much of the body of Christ tossed to and fro. Carried about with every wind of doctrine, everything come along. By the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But what? Speaking the truth in love. Speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together. See, we fitly joined together. If you're not here, I know you're not here. I'm missing something. Now, listen to me. Don't get under no condemnation. There'll be times and situations and things will come up that you maybe cannot be here. I fully and completely understand that. Okay? I ain't throwing no condemnation. Some folk work and all that stuff. Duly noted, duly good. But when you can. Because, okay, the praise team be up here. Let me just give you an example. There's Dab, Shay, Pam, Tiffany, Deacon Willie on the guitar, Constance on the keyboard, Matisse on the drums, or CJ on the drums. Now, all of them are up here and we don't have a drummer. Can't y'all, will y'all not miss that sound? When Deep and Overseer was out honeymooning, did we not miss the sound of that guitar? Ooh, hear the Spirit of God, y'all. So you think it don't matter when you ain't here. But there's a sound only you make. There's a sound when you put your sound and I put my sound. See, this morning when we was praising God, God knew Mother Carmichael's hallelujah from mine. But they were coming up together, a sweet incense, a sweet fragrance in his nostrils. by which every joint supplies, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, make an increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. This I say, therefore, and testify in the Lord, that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their what? Mind. In the vanity of their mind, what they can come up with. Having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart. See, the God of this world has blinded the minds of men and women that they won't see the truth, they won't know the truth, who being past feeling have given themselves over. Now, listen to this right here. Who being past feeling have given themselves over. You don't say nothing about the devil right there, does it? Who gave themselves over? Come on, talk to me. Having given themselves over unto lasciviousness. Lasciviousness just simply means no restraint. You just say anything, do anything. There's nothing to restrain you. To work all uncleanness with greediness. But ye have not so learned Christ. You've not so. If you would go and look, and here's a little box, and the cat just have kittens. Now, if you find some puppies in there, we got a problem. When you look in there and they say she had 10 babies, it ought to be 10 kittens. Not 5 kittens, 2 rats, and 2 dogs. No. So if Christ is in you, the only thing you should be reproducing is Christ. His image, his love. That's the only thing you should be, that's the only thing that should be reduplicating out of your life. Because that's the seed that's in you. Christ is not a damner, he's a blesser. You've not so learned Christ. So if you didn't learn that from Christ, where'd you get it from? If so be that ye have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in who? The truth is in Jesus. Every beloved, every word in this Bible is true. It's the truth of God. Now, it's some statements in here that have been truly stated. But they're not true, because Job said, the Lord give, the Lord take. Now, that was truly stated, but that's not a word of truth. But everything what thus said the Lord is true. That ye put off. Who put off? Who put off? God's not going to put it off. He has given you the ability. He's given you the Holy Spirit. He's given you the anointing. He's given you the power to do it. He will help you do it, but he's not going to do it for you. That ye put off concerning the former conversation or lifestyle of the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust. That just means he just the realm. You just go by your feelings. What you can see, that realm. And 23, and what? Be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Only thing that can renew your mind is the word of God. The only thing that let me know how greatly loved I am by God is his word. The only thing that let me know that he's not holding anything against me is his word. The only thing that let me know that he's for me and he's never going to leave me is his word. So we need to be renewed in the spirit of our mind. 1 Peter 1 and 13 says, wherefore gird up the loins of your mind. Be sober. Sober don't just mean don't be drunk. Sober means be clear-headed. Have right thinking. And hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Colossians 3 and 2. Set your affection on things above. Set your affection. That means you have to do it. So many of us, God, why won't you do this? God said, I've given you power. And I've given you authority. They teach this thing when Paul told Jesus, asked God to remove the thorn from his flesh. And people say, God said, no, that's not what he said. God said, I have given you power and authority over all the works of the enemy. You tell it to go. He said, I'm not going to tell him to go. Before I went to the cross, before I went into the bowels of hell, before I was supernaturally raised from the dead, I had to do all that for you. But now that I'm seated at the right hand of the Father, now that I've sent the Holy Spirit back to live on the inside of you, now that I've given you the authority of my name, the power of my blood, the anointing of the Holy Ghost, now you resist the devil and he has to flee. A lot of us, God, why won't you make the devil leave me alone? He's putting you everything you need to make the devil leave you alone. He's not going to do it. He's not going to do it. Now, he'll help you, but he's not going to do it. You're going to have to stand up in your sonship. And you're going to have to use your authority. And you're going to have to tell the devil, you ain't coming in here. You ain't messing up my house. I see you. Because where there's strife, there's every evil work. Don't you kid yourself. When you get into strife, you open the door and you told every devil, every demon, every principality, every wickedness, every perverse, come on in, make yourself at home, unpack your bags and stay a while. Tear up my house, tear up my cars, tear up my finances. That's what you told him to do. Because nobody wants to put in the work. Do you know Jesus could have said no? Have you all thought about that? He could have said no. Do you remember in the word where he said, I lay my life down, didn't nobody take it? Well, if he laid it down, he could have took it up. When they stopped beating him on, beating him, he could have said, enough of this. I gave y'all something good from the beginning and y'all messed it up. It's on y'all. Do the best way you can. He didn't do that. Why? Because he loves us. We need to love God the same. So we're going to start renewing our minds. I'm going to close. I'll let you come up for air. But this it's serious. I'm serious. I wept and cried last night and prayed in the Holy Ghost. Labored before the Lord. Because some of us have built a place for him in our lives. We built a place for him in our homes. Because we sit and watch anything on TV. Some of y'all may say, it ain't that serious. Yes, it is. It's that serious. Because faith got come by hearing, and so does fear, so does unbelief, so does perverseness. Nothing, everything will seem to be all right. He puts laughter on it. Make you laugh at it. They use all kind of nasty language. Sitting up seeing two men licking on each other, two women licking on each other, and you laugh and you think that's all right. That's filth and it's perverseness. And God said it's an abomination in the sight of the Lord. Woo! Thank God for communion table. We've been redeemed, y'all. We've got so much power and so much authority. And the earth is groaning for the manifestations of the sons of God. They say, where are the body of Christ? Why are we going through all this turbulence? Where is the voice? When Jesus walked the earth, we knew who was running things. He said, but he left and went away, and he gave it to his church. Where is the voice of the church? Why are we in such an upheaval? Why is there so much sickness? Why is there so much disease? Why is there so much death? We look at it and we say, oh, there's so much death. Have you stood up and defied that spirit of death? Have you ordered it back to the pit of hell where it came from? And the earth is just groaning and groaning. Hurricanes and tornadoes said, we'll come and tear up a city. Because all we got to do is put it in one man's mouth. And they'll start echoing and echoing. And every time they echo it, it give us strength. Won't you start standing up and resisting with the word of the living God? Start renewing your mind of, first of all, who you are in Christ. The authority and the power you've been given through his name and through his blood. Renewing your mind. We got to get serious, y'all. It's serious times. These are serious times. We got to be, you put these men up here a few Sundays ago, the gatekeepers. Then they put the wives behind. Don't let that get away from you. Don't let that get away from you. You the gatekeepers of your home. Something's going on in there you don't like, you let it in. Same way you let it in, put it out. Stand to your feet. I think that's it. Did you receive? I mean, can you all see? Let me ask this. Can y'all see my heart? God knows I want the best for every person in here. I want y'all to be happy. I mean, I not just, oh, blessing, hallelujah. No, I want you to have the real joy of the Lord in your heart. I want you to have the money you need to pay your bills. I want you to be able to lay down at night and you got peace. I want you to have a revelation of God that just washes over you like waves. I want you to know you're so wrapped up in God's love that he's not mad at you, he's not angry at you, he's not upset with you. I want you to have good jobs and good careers and good relationships. But honey, we won't do it apart from the word. We got to do it God's way. We got to do it God's way. Stand to your feet. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for your word today. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that the seed of this word will go down deep into the soil of the hearts of your people. Father, I pray that this word would awaken them to righteousness. Lord God, it will help them to see the power and the authority that they have in the name of Jesus. Lord, they will see and understand that we too can change things with the words of our mouth. Father, I ask that you will cultivate such a hunger and a thirst in the hearts and the minds of your people. A longing to be with you, a longing for intimacy, a longing to get to know you. We thank you, Father God, that you love us. Thank you that you said you never leave nor forsake us. Thank you that you're a God of mercy. Oh, I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful for your mercy. I'm so grateful for your goodness. You're a long-suffering God. Thank you for the great plan you have for our lives. Lord, I bless you for this house. I thank you for these great people of God. I thank you that the plans you have for them will succeed. I pray for their families. I pray for their homes. I pray for their finances. I pray if they need jobs, God, that you would give them good jobs. If they need a home, God, you'll give them a home. If they need a car, God, you'll give them a car. If they need health in their body, Father, that you will let your healing power flow from the crown of their heads to the soles of their feet. If they need their marriage worked on, God. If they need the children's situation worked on, oh God. Father, I just pray that you'll meet every need. I thank you for divine protection. I thank you for covering our children. I plead the blood of Jesus over every school, over every school, every bus rider, every car rider, the library, the cafeteria, every person, every resource. I pray for every business in here, God. I pray for favor. Oh, da 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 ba sheka ro ro bo se te. I pray for favor, God. Connect them with the right people, God. Don't let them get involved in anything that will bring them down or shut their business down. Help them to be people of integrity and honor, God, and you can show yourself strong on their behalf. God, I thank you and I bless you. Ooh, shada-da-da-da-ba, sotororobo, shekirene. Tish, I cover you. I cover you in Jesus' name. As you on that road, dear Jesus, let your battalion of angels cover her. No accidents, no road rage of any kind. I pray for your business, Corey. I pray for your business, Dre. Matisse. Sharon. Laura, your business. All of you that's got a business. I pray that God would give you creative ideas. Those of you that are in management, Joyce, you've been teaching a long time. You see a lot of things now. I pray that God will hear your prayers as you intercede. You, just being you, you can turn this thing. Pray for every marriage in here. Pray for heaven's atmosphere to sit down in your homes. Jesus. Lord, I blessed. Pray for the books that are to be written. Pray for your business, Dre. See, we've got power and authority to cause things to come to pass. What's the dream in your heart? What is it you believe in God to do? Earth is groaning. I pray for every one of our children. No hurt, no harm, no accidents of any kind. When they're in our presence and when they're away from our presence. I pray for our teens. Oh, I cover every person in here with the blood of Jesus. I pray for every husband in here. God will give you what you need to take care of your families the way you want to take care of them. No lack of any kind. I encourage you to make him first. Get along with God. Get along with God. Because what you don't know, he knows. He wants to help you. I pray for every wife. You're a good helpmeet. Every husband's prayer should be, Father, make me the kind of husband that she needs. You know her, you made her. She's not only my wife, she's my sister in the Lord. Every wife, your prayer should be, Lord, make me the wife that he needs. You made him. Help me understand him. Help me to pray for him. All you singles, I pray for you in your singleness. I don't care where you are in life, you'll have struggles. If you marry, a believer, you're going to have problems. If you marry an unbeliever, you're going to have problems. If you don't marry, you're going to have problems. That's life. But God, I cover each and every one of you with the blood. And I'm asking God as a favor to me today. Every last one of you that have sowed seeds in my life, I'm going to ask God to do a rapid turnaround on that seed, because it's an honor seed. And I'm going to ask God to do a rapid turnaround because you sowed it in honor. And I want God to supernaturally speed up the increase on that seed to come back to you in the way that you need it. Because I do thank you. I do thank you from my heart. I do. And I bless you. And I just speak the peace and the love of God to cover each and every one of you in the precious name of Jesus.